welcome to today's presentation. I'd like to also acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we work and gather, that of the Turrbal and Yuggera peoples, and pay my respects to all elders, past and present. As a visiting fellow of the Harry Gentle Resource Centre, I wish to also acknowledge the generous assistance and support of the Gentle family. My presentation today is titled, "Of All the Wild Schemes, This Seems to Be the Wildest." This quote is a small detail from a letter written on the 22nd of January, 1849 by Captain John Wickham. And he was writing to Police Magistrate Francis Merriweather, who was the immigration agent. Wickham continued, writing of the impending arrival of the Fortitude, that sending 270 people to a strange country without having made the slightest arrangements for their reception was, he thought, difficult. And he intimated that, indeed, it was only through a newspaper report that we had any idea of such a ship being on the way to Moreton Bay. He was, of course, referring to the imminent arrival in January 1849 of the Fortitude, arranged by the Reverend John Dunmore Lang. But the sentiment he voiced holds true also for all the passengers on the Artemisia. Imagine coming from England in 1848 into a Queensland summer, mid-December. The air conditioning was non-existent, provisions were low, and accommodation rudimentary. And there was also no fly spray, no mosquito repellent. And this quote by one young lady to her sister back in England, she was writing a letter, I think sums it all up. "You say I told you nothing about the climate, but what, with the dust and heat and hot winds and flies and an insect they call a mosquito, we do not know what to do with ourselves just now. It makes me quite cold to think of winter yet, for just now we are all just melted with heat." It's interesting to note that Lang's immigration scheme was perhaps the catalyst that prompted the government commissioners to scramble together and organise the Artemisia, the first vessel government assisted with around 240 passengers on board. And I had a little smile to myself, because what motivated Lang to act was the perceived lack of moral standards in Moreton Bay, and also the increasing numbers of Roman Catholics. He was concerned that Protestantism would be undermined, and so he rounded up about 700 mainly Presbyterian Scots and organised to ship them to Australia. His ships included, of course, the Fortitude, Chasely, and the Lima. The Fortitude was the first of Lang's vessels to arrive in Moreton Bay and came hot on the tails of the Artemisia. Now, this resulted in the Moreton Bay district of New South Wales and the little settlement of Brisbane of roughly about 800 people then, desperately short on supplies, being inundated with new colonists and almost doubling the population within just a year. Police Magistrate Wickham was concerned about accommodating the new arrivals. In the Colonial Secretary's correspondence, there's a wealth of letters to and fro. This one was dated November and was written even before the Artemisia arrived. "Sir, in acknowledging the receipt of your letter of the 30th ultimo, I do myself the honour to inform you that His Excellency the Governor approves of the emigrants expected to arrive at Moreton Bay on the Artemisia being accommodated in the prisoner barracks, as you proposed. And he goes on, etc., etc. And in respect to your suggestion that a more suitable building for the reception of immigrants should be erected, I am directed to say that this must be deferred. Now, apart from primary records like this one and the newspapers and shipping lists, I found that not much had been written about the Artemisia. The older history books tend to record the famous, the great deeds and the events, while those deemed ordinary, such as the tradesmen, labourers and servants, who were the type of immigrants on the Artemisia, have been relegated to lesser realms. This produces a biased view of history. For example, we know that women were not written into history until 1970, and they comprised 50% of the population. The first peoples, First Nations people and ethnic minorities, and also other categories, welfare categories, have also not been given the attention that they deserve. I believe that this is why this research is so important, to tease out the stories of so-called ordinary people, the women and children, the servants and labourers, and build the knowledge about early communities, to look at their emotions and their experiences, to wonder at the challenges that faced them, the interactions and exchanges, and delve into the very reasons for their existence. I thought it was quite amazing that A.G. Davis gave a paper about immigration and immigrant ships of Moreton Bay at a meeting of the Historical Society of Queensland in 1935. Ronald Wood, in 1990, and to the same society, could still comment over 50 years later that, and I quote, "Little is known about the passengers of the Artemisia in contrast to those who came by Dunmore Lang ships in 1849. In more recent times, the works by Rod Fisher and Jennifer Harrison and of Stephanie Ryan of Queensland State Library and of a host of family historians and genealogists and historians with regard to the Artemisia and its passengers must be commended. Perhaps Wickham's quote rings true for what I proposed. Of all the wild schemes, this seems to be the wildest. That is, to research the Artemisia and importantly, to reconstruct the lives of her passengers. There were only about 240 of them, so as to glean some meaning or emerging themes based on biographical narrative and documents. As you can imagine, there were quite a few challenges. But first, a little bit about the Artemisia. Built in Sunderland, she was a beautiful large bark. She was owned by Anthony Ridley and captained by his nephew, John Prest Ridley, from 1848 to 1853. A journalist from the Illustrated London News, on her maiden voyage, wrote in August 1848 that the Artemisia was a fine ship, all spick and span new. He felt it unnecessary to describe the interior of the vessel. The arrangement of the ship chartered by the commissioners is generally the same. The upper deck was handsomely fitted so as to accommodate passengers of the better class. Here the reporter tasted the provisions for the immigrants, the biscuits, beef and pork, and found them of excellent quality. He now inspected the accommodation between decks, where a number of the passengers were seated, some playing with their children, others reading, a mixture of excitement and sadness. I think a picture tells a thousand words. And this one is called The Last of England by Maddox Brown. It's a poignant painting and a reminder that there was a mixture of excitement and sadness. That last look at England, when the shores faded away and they got further and further away, could be very painful. Because in those days, communication wasn't the same as it is today. You couldn't just pick up a phone and call your relatives. It was quite different. A starting point for the project were the shipping lists. I found at least three differing original passenger lists. I think this is because of the embarkation and immigration papers and the different ports that the Artemisia called into. You can see here that they look different. They've got different columns and different information. So mainly they comprised surname, given names, age, occupation or calling, native place, parents' names, whether parents were alive or dead, whether the immigrant had relations in the colony, the state of bodily health, strength, and the probable usefulness of the immigrant. Now, there are obvious anomalies within the numbers that disembarked in Australia, but this could be reflected and explained in the three who died during the voyage. One was a Mrs. Faulkner who died of stomach cancer, and she was buried at sea. And there were also four births during the voyage. So 200 men, women and children embarked from London, 31 from Plymouth. There was one lady that had been jilted by her boyfriend. She was supposed to be engaged, and she was so hysterical that they let her off at Plymouth, and somebody else might have got on, but I haven't worked out who yet. And around 241 were landed in Australia. Some of the crew also remained in Australia. There was James Greenfield and John Loudon, both seamen, and they were charged with assaulting Robert Scott, one of the passengers, and they spent 2 months in Sydney jail. William Nichols, another sailor, absconded, and they were still looking for him in March 1849 in Australia. And also the captain, John Prest Ridley, eventually married and settled down in Sydney. I began by transcribing the shipping lists. The name of each immigrant, as well as their relevant information, was compiled into one spreadsheet from all the information that I had available. Then the colonial newspapers and all the familiar genealogical and historical data, plus the public record, is in the process of being added to each name so that a composite portrait of each person and each family will be constructed or reconstructed. I also created some computer files for each surname, as well as other things in that list. And these hold relevant digital copies of documents and references. You can see I have Biogs Alpha above the aqua arrow, and then below the arrow is the family College Hewitt and all the relevant documents. The one highlighted is a marriage certificate for the 25th of December, 1838. They were married on Christmas Day. A preliminary and cursive glance at the shipping records illustrated inconsistencies and anomalies, and this is quite usual for a lot of these lists. Some can be easily verified. For example, Bedworth, Warwickshire, is wrongly recorded as Bulworth, Cornwall. Pennell, a village near Harrogate in North Yorkshire, is recorded as Parnell, P-A-R-N-A-L. Edward Crabtree, aged 15, shown on this list, and Anne Crabtree, a 19-year-old nurse, entered in both the single females and also under families on the indexes, were brother and sister. The birthplaces of the Crabtree family are given variously as Dewsbury, as here, D-U-S-E-B-U-R-Y, or T apostrophe B-U-R-Y. He's entered here as I said, as Dewsbury. But I had a note to myself in my notes, and it read, T apostrophe Bury, Yorkshire, spelt D-U-S-E-B-U-R-Y under families, possibly T-U-W-S-B-U-R-Y. And any of the genealogists in the room will know this is a conundrum. Tracked down, Anne's official records reveal she was baptised on the 17th of May 1829 at All Saints Church in Dewsbury, D-E-W-S-B-U-R-Y, in Yorkshire. Another young lady, Amy College, clearly spelt E-D-G-E and E-G-E on the shipping lists, was 14 years and a single female, and she was the daughter of George and Elizabeth, whose name was spelt I-D-G-E on the same ship, on the same lists. Now, these comments are in no way a criticism of the records or of previous histories. The official record, like this one here, is often notoriously difficult to decipher. Number 34 on the shipping list for single males was that of William Edmiston Shearing, aged 14 years and a carpenter. If you were a relative of his in Australia looking for him, you would be searching for Roberts. This is William Shearing, and we're going to hear more about William later. The spelling and confusion of names could be explained through clerks trying to decipher the different dialects and accents and then write them down. Now, this was really hard for even people travelling together to understand different dialects. For example, Robert Inglis wrote a journal about the Artemisia, and he wrote that when a scuffle took place at the cooking galley, a sort of panic was created among the immigrants by one or two women screaming in a loud provincial dialect, "A fighting!" And it sounded like the appalling cry of, "A fire!" Everyone seemed pleased that it was only a row between the cook and the coffee roaster. And I think that's lovely because it shows us that there was a coffee roaster on board. Although we often refer to these immigrants generally as passengers, or we might refer to immigrants as WASP, white Anglo-Saxon Protestants, it's clear that they were a diverse mixture of personalities, cultures, dialects, religious beliefs, and peoples. The type of research that we're doing allows you to look at the diversity amongst these people. Robert Inglis, himself a literate man who wrote a journal on board, is a prime example of a mismatch of detail within lists and a reminder to check even the original registers and original sources. Inglis was born on the 4th of January 1805 at Shotts, Cambusnethin, Lanarkshire in Scotland. The 1841 census of Scotland records him as Ingalls rather than Inglis. His departure from England is sometimes given as Plymouth, but we know this is inaccurate because in his journal he writes that he stayed at Deptford Depot, and he gives a beautiful description about a tour around London before they got on the Artemisia. His arrival in Moreton Bay is variously given as the 6th of December, the Artemisia was in Sydney on that date, or the 16th of December. Quite obviously, somebody's just left a one off. Still more anomalies abound. His daughter Margaret is recorded as being born in Palia, P-A-L-I-A, Victoria. When you track her birth certificate down, she was born in 1859 at Ballarat East in Victoria. And you can see the change there, B-A-L-L-A and P-A-L-I-A. They're fairly similar. And it was all of those differences within the one family of Inglis. As I said, the Inglis family came from Shotts in Scotland, and this is a photo I took in 2016 of the district near there. And incidentally, my great-great-grandfather was born at Shotts, so that's why I had this photograph. When the first wife of Robert Inglis died, he married his housekeeper, Janet Ewer. U-R-E, and I think there's a Ewer Street around here somewhere. 3 years later, they sailed on the Artemisia with some of the Inglis children. On arrival in Moreton Bay, they bought a property in South Brisbane on the 15th of August, 1849, and their movements can then be traced through the births of their offspring. They went back to Scotland. On researching the Inglis family, I came across connections, interactions, and strands that weren't overly obvious. This is a simplified, very simplified family history chart showing the Ewer family with the mother and father at the top and the siblings underneath, or their children underneath. I found that three of the Ewer siblings emigrated on the Artemisia in 1848. And you'll see the icon of the ship on the names of those who immigrated. On the first glance, the names on the shipping list did not match with the family connections. There was Janet Inglis, Barbara McNaught, and William Ewer. Janet Inglis had married Janet Ewer had married Robert Inglis. Barbara Ewer had married Daniel McNaught, and William Ewer didn't, he was a single male. But there was more. The Inglis, Ewer, McNaught, Petrie, and Bottomley families are all related. Jane Keith McNaught, the sister of Daniel McNaught and sister-in-law of Barbara Ewer, emigrated as a single woman. Her occupation was nurse. She married John Petrie on the 5th of September, 1850 in Brisbane. She became the first mayoress of Brisbane. The Bottomleys and McNaughts are also connected through the marriage of the children. And this would mean that these families actually kept in touch for roughly 20 or 30 or 40 years. So that their children knew each other, they still knew each other, and they married. The State Library of Queensland has some wonderful images of the Petrie family you'll see here. The one in the middle is really important because it's the staff of Petrie, the building contractor, around 1867. Daniel McNaught is probably sitting somewhere in the front there, because after seeking gold right throughout New South Wales, he came back to Brisbane and he worked for John Petrie, his sister's husband, or his brother-in-law? The Amy's family is another one that provides evidence of family descendants and connections. This family shows the importance of genealogy. Oops, that wasn't me. Thomas and Phoebe Amy's and their three-month-old baby, John Amy's, emigrated to Moreton Bay. I can't imagine what life would be like on a ship for 4 months with a three-month-old child. It would be really difficult. This is a photograph around 1860 of Thomas and his family. He was a blacksmith, and I feel his contribution to civic life and his story is uplifting as an indicative of many of the Artemisian passengers. The family moved to Warwick in 1849, establishing a farrier business there, and they were amongst the first Europeans in the district. When Queensland's first governor paid his first official visit to Warwick in 1860, instead of a gun salute to welcome the governor, Messrs. Amy's and Craig, who were in charge of all arrangements in connection with the salute, had organised an anvil battery in lieu of cannons. The anvils were all charged with gunpowder, the wads being pegs of wood driven home by sledgehammers and weighted down by heavy weights. As the imposing cavalcade came into town, the salute was fired in perfect time, with excellent effect, amidst the wildest excitement. Amy's, in his obituary, was described as a familiar figure in the streets, a man of the kindliest nature, a tradesman who took pride in his work, a generous friend and a loyal citizen. And he earned the esteem of all with whom he came in contact with. Thomas Amy's was active in municipal matters. He was involved in the first Wesleyan church in Warwick. Until a month or two before his death in his 73rd year, he worked hard, and he died from complications and heart trouble in 1895 at Warwick. I remembered in previous research that an Amy's family was involved in the Eureka riots in Ballarat in 1854. And Amy's is not a common name, so I shot off an email to friends of mine, and I got one back immediately. "Hello, Dot. What a pleasant surprise to hear from you, and I'm chuffed to hear you to learn that you are still thinking of me and my family history. The first thing is to say, bingo, you have found my Amy's. Well done." Peter goes on to explain his Amy's family. He's descended from John, who was a brother to Thomas. "If you want more," he wrote, "just ask." What's also remarkable about these comments and connections is that Peter and I went to high school together and we sat on the cemetery advisory committee together. These and the previous slide show some of the sources used to determine that John and Thomas were siblings. You'll notice on this that some go back to 1795 with John Amy Sr.'s birth, and 1817, that little scrap with his marriage to Mary Ann Child. These records provide a wealth of information. They're just some of the records and sources used in the search to prove that Thomas and John were brothers. And sometimes research like this can go back 100, 200, even sometimes 300 years. So it's not all forward research. It can span states and countries too. Thomas Amy's brother, John Amy's, and his wife, Emma, had a tent inside the Eureka stockade. And when the fighting started, they put flour bags against the wall so the bullets wouldn't hit their little baby, Elizabeth. In later life, Elizabeth wrote a journal about all this, and that's how we know. She also married Joseph Benjamin. And this is quite amazing because the person that actually gave me permission to use the family photo of the Amys also had a photo of Joseph Benjamin. So it was really quite connected. The Barker family provides still more evidence of family connections on board the Artemisia. The shipping lists are set out in families, single females and single males, and this is part of the family part of it. And you can see there, there's a John Barker, Hannah Barker, and their son, Anthony, who was an infant. Then looking at the single males, we find a Benjamin Barker. He was listed among the single males, and he was actually a brother of John. We can then trace the movements of the parents through the births of their children, because these reflect the location they were in. The Barker family were in Yorkshire, 1847, Queensland, 1848, North Brisbane, 1850, and Specimen Gully in Bendigo in 1855. But you'll see there's a little bit of a gap there. I turned to Trove and we found some advertisements. The one on the left is dated 1852, and that places John Barker in Melbourne. His chestnut horse was either lost or stolen, so he was advertising for it. The newspaper on the right places Benjamin in George Street, Sydney, in 1861. He died in tragic circumstances of a ruptured blood vessel. So there was still a little bit of a gap missing, but amazing connections here. We can place them in Bendigo in 1853. Both John and Benjamin signed the 1853 Bendigo Goldfields Petition. They're recorded in the index. Of course, agitation started on the Victorian goldfields with the Forest Creek Monster Meeting in 1851. But what became known as the Red Ribbon Movement was centred around the Bendigo goldfields in 1853, and specifically in Specimen Gully, where they were living. A James Barker also signed this petition, and he's thought to be another brother, and he moved again to Massachusetts in USA. John Barker died 1898. Hannah Barker died on the 18th of October 1907, aged 85 years. What a life. From family connections, we now look at some of the themes and strands that run through the project. There were stories passed down. There were ragged school people. There were weavers and women, and William Shearing Roberts. Through some of the stories passed down, through families, we can often glean information that's not forthcoming in just the dry old records. These stories often can, in the case of the carpenters, shed light on why these people emigrated. I would never ever have known this story without being in touch with the family descendants. And all of this adds colour and depth, making the story personal. So thank you very much, Chris, for this. The carpenters were living near the Boyle Arsenal, just downriver from Greenwich or Woolwich. These Google maps show London and where downstream Greenwich and Woolwich are. James Carpenter and Mary Ann Hickman married on the 14th of April, 1845. By September 1843, they married. By September 1845, they had one child, James, and Mary Ann was again pregnant. They lived at 7 Union Road, Woolwich, near Beresford Square, which was adjacent to the main gate of the Woolwich Royal Arsenal. James was a short walk from the arsenal, where he worked as a white worker. Family history was passed down that James had hearing problems and headaches as the result of an accident. An explosion occurred there at 10 a.m. on the 17th of September 1845 in a small workshop near the southern end of the model room belonging to the Royal Laboratory, used for breaking up condemned fuses. 7 persons were killed, and it's probable that James was in the model room as he suffered from hearing problems and headaches as a result of the explosion. James was advised to move to a better climate, and his wife Mary Ann agreed with his doctors. His descendants are well known in Australia, but that's the reason they were on the Artemisia. Another strand that I will be following up in more detail is that of the 7 boys and 2 girls from the ragged school. And somebody said to me, what are ragged schools? Lord Ashley formed the Ragged School Union in 1844, and by 1853, more than 200 free schools for children were established in the United Kingdom. Charles Dickens was a prominent supporter. It's reflected in Oliver Twist and A Christmas Carol. The idea was to give poor children or orphans an education. The Illustrated London News recorded the visit of Lord Ashley to the Artemisia, as did Robert Ingalls in his journal. A highlight of the departure was a visit by Lord Ashley, who had interested himself in sending out boys and girls from the ragged school. These were aboard, all decently rigged out, and under the care of a Mr. C, a Bible Society agent. He came aboard, gave a suitable address to the passengers, distributed prayer books, and sold Bibles at 6p and Testaments at 2p each. I don't think anything much has changed. Our William Edward Shearing Roberts, who we met before, was a ragged schoolboy, and I didn't know this until I started researching him. He changed his name from Shearing to Roberts, and all his descendants are Roberts, and I haven't found out exactly why yet. When William was born on the 13th of March in 1836 at Lambeth, his father Edward was 23, and his mother, Elizabeth, was 20. His sister, Anne, was born in 1838 at Lambeth too. William lived in Newington, Surrey, and according to the 1841 census, he was with his paternal grandparents, mother, father, and sister, Anne. That same year, his father, Edward John Shearing, passed away at the age of 28. Then his grandmother passed away in 1846 and his grandfather in 1848. His sister Anne was described as a pauper in the workhouse, and there's no sign of his mother. William was in the ragged school at Westminster, and this is how he came to be on the Artemisia. He arrived in Queensland in 1846, and on the shipping list his age is given as 14 years, but my maths makes this accurate. By 2 years, he was 12. He worked on large sheep stations until 1854, when he and his mate left Queensland and set out overland for Adelaide on foot. Striking the river, it's said that they made bark canoes and paddled downstream. They went to Kangaroo Island, South Australia, and took up droving between Port Lincoln and Fowler's Bay. William was employed by Maribel and Miller of Point Bell Station, and then Mr. W.B. Swan and Company, on his Fowler's Bay station. William Edward Roberts married Mary Elizabeth Dowling on December the 26th, 1863, when he was 27 years old. The newly married pair left Adelaide in the cutter Firefly and arrived in Point Bell 15 days later. Here, William signed on with Messrs. Marabella Miller again as a shepherd, and he remained in Fowler's Bay until 1888. They had 10 children in 21 years. When leases were thrown open in 1888, William selected land between Streaky Bay and Kalka, part of the original Maryvale station of Mr. W. A. Horn. From 1888 till 1907, he was at Oakvale, Streaky Bay. I found this absolutely wonderful family photo in the Southern Cross of 1912. The article at the front is written by Gordon to an aunt, Eily or Ellie. These were newspaper letters to people. And he's the one, second from the left at the back, in the family photo. The article at the back is the obituary of his mother and wife of William. William's wife passed away on the 4th of January 1906 at the age of 61. They had been married 44 years. William Edward Shearing Roberts died on the 24th of February 1914 at Streaky Bay when he was 78 years old. And he's buried at Pied Nippy Catholic Cemetery. His obituary there on the right states he came on the Artemisia. So it is the same fellow. This one I've called Movers and Shakers. And I need to do much more research to make a coherent picture of these pieces. But I included them to show the scope that this research could take. On the slide, we have Lord Ashley and Sir Sidney Herbert, the Brisbane Hospital, a wool bale, and the cover of Lloyd's Register and the mate's certificate of Captain John Prest Ridley. And you're going to wonder how on earth all of these match or the reason for them. Ashley was in close contact with Sidney Herbert, and when Herbert proposed the Sidney Herbert immigration scheme, Ashley's name was included as one of the bankers. You'll see the writing down here. They both believed that emigration was the solution to Britain's overcrowding and poor. The photo of Brisbane Hospital has Dr. Frederick James Barton standing on the veranda, and he was one of the first doctors there. A Dr. George Kingston Barton was the surgeon of the Artemisia. Both were born in Ireland around the same time. Were they brothers or cousins? And thank you to Ruth Kerr, John Pern, and Cliff Pollard for their help with the hospital and that one. The wool bale is indicative of the cargo transported on the return voyage of the Artemisia. She notably carried produce for the Australian Agricultural Company. The Artemisia's second voyage saw her leave London on the 5th of September 1849 via Plymouth, arriving in Sydney on the 27th of December 1849. She then sailed to Port Stephens or Newcastle, landing iron and machinery for the Australian Agricultural Company coal mine. This one, I think, is really worth a closer look. The AACO was established as a land development company in 1824 with the assistance of a British Parliament Crown grant of 1 million acres in the Port Stephens region of New South Wales. Today, the AAECO is a public listed Australian company that has, as at 2018, owned and operated feedlots and farms covering around 7 million hectares on land in Queensland and the Northern Territory, roughly 1% of Australia's land mass. Another strand worth following up are the families that immigrated to Brisbane, who were weavers and miners from the Bedworth and Coventry areas. Some were described as ribbon weavers, and this is the sort of ribbon that they were weaving. It's an example of a silk ribbon, and it's held in the Victoria and Albert Museum in London. The contingent on the Artemisia from Bedworth near Coventry were Butler, Compton, Neil, and College. The women of the Artemisia is another strand I'm interested in more depth. How many of these women were suffragettes later on? How many sat on charity committees? There are many more questions than answers. Around a quarter of the passengers were adult women, the others on board being married and single men and children. Around 75% of all the adult women were married, leaving 25% or 19 single. At least two of the single women married convicts. One ended up in Tasmania. Some were part of family groups, others had relatives in the country. There were lots of posters enticing women into Australia. Jobs were sent to be plentiful. Husbands were available and plenty. And remember the early gender imbalance. But the commissioners and immigrant agents wanted women of good morals and industrious habits. Some women, however, just didn't fit the bill. They didn't follow the protocol of being good moral citizens. Anne Marie Kelly was well known to the inhabitants of Fortitude Valley as the queen of the Artemisia. She was not part of the stereotype of the good woman. Certain peculiarities of manner earned Miss Kelly the nickname of the Queen of the Artemisia on her voyage to the New World. In later life, she was given to displays of theatrical gentility in unlikely surroundings. I think at one stage she threw herself into the Brisbane River. She married David Powell in 1849. They had a turbulent relationship. They were in and out of court, obscene language, assault, and drunken disorderly. They tried for a new start in Ipswich, but there are blow-by-blow descriptions in the court records and in the local newspapers. She died at 48 years of age in 1868. To conclude, these are some of the connections, interactions, and strands that we've discussed today. There are many other possibilities. There's one strand I'd like to explore in more detail and one I haven't dealt with in this talk today. That is the interactions between the women, men and children from the Artemisia with the First Nations people. As I indicated previously, some hidden chapters have been sliced off our histories, and it is fitting and timely that there are respected historians addressing this collective amnesia. Extensive research such as this brings forth a myriad of possibilities of untold connections, strands, and interactions. This research questions and challenges stereotypes and generalisations. The Artemisia immigrants were diverse. They presented different dialects, different customs, religious beliefs, and cultures. It's important because it uncovers previously hidden histories, stories of so-called ordinary people, of tradesmen, labourers, drovers, some with extraordinary tales to tell. The historical lens can shift. You can put an emphasis on experiences and feelings. It highlights connections, interfamily relationships, locality and regional connections. There are so many exciting new themes emerging. The research is broad, spanning time as well as regional frames, intercolonial and transnational patterns. It brings together ideas and unlikely strands. I believe the research is worthwhile. The reconstructed lives of passengers present not only some remarkable and often incredible stories, but they have the potential to unlock a host of different strands and a host of more projects. The names of these passengers will be added to the dictionary at the Harry Gentle Resource Centre. The stories and biographies can then be utilised and built upon. And I have no doubt in the future that more strands, interactions and connections will be revealed as this search progresses. And that, I feel, is one of the most exciting parts of the research. Thank you so much.